Section 13.2, Troubleshooting Client Connections. Well, one of the best places to go to start troubleshooting these client connections is within operations called Network Manager Statistics. This plugin is going to visualize all the different connections to the server, and it tells you a lot of information about it. You know, it tells you, well, just a whole variety of things. The name of the connected application. So this is that stuff that we had previously been deriving from the message logs. So here's the name. PI PE, as you notice, that's the first four characters plus the letter E. These are some of the different interfaces that are API based. You can see them with the E at the end. And then for the SDK based applications, you'll see these things are much, you're going to see the full name. But it shows you that. It shows you things like the IP address of the connecting client. So if we scroll over, you can see the IP address of, you know, how this data is coming in. There we go. And there's just the number of bytes received, the number of messages received. If you've got errors, if you have a lot of errors listed in here, let me show you. Yeah, there's that address we were talking about. If you've got a number of errors, this would be indicative of some kind of a network problem. So this is a very good troubleshooting tool. It may be something that, by yourself, it's not a lot you can do with it, but when you're on the phone with tech support, they may ask you to come take a look at this. Now, there's an apparent contradiction that you'll find sometimes with trusts and explicit logins. Let me explain what I mean. If you look in the System Manager Guide, you'll see explicitly we state that a trust login and an explicit login are independent from each other, and the explicit login will always override the trust login. In other words, if you explicitly log in as a specified user, that will override the trust. However, in practice, what you'll notice is the trusts for several of our applications appear to supersede the explicit login. And actually, the reason for this is because some of the applications like ProcessBook and DataLink and the other connecting applications, they actually attempt to verify a trust first, and then if that doesn't work, then they'll do an explicit login. Let me demonstrate, and I'll show you the workaround. See, if this is a, let's say I've got a trust set up, I'll just create a new trust here, and I'll call this the Too Liberal Trust, because this is a trust that's just going to let me connect simply based on my computer name, NickGX280, and let's say that it's going to give me the user Emily. Okay. Now, let me exit out of System Management Tools. I created that trust on the PI server, or that trust exists on the PI server, so I'm going to connect now with the client. And when I make this connection, when I start trying to look at things, what you might notice is that it's going to look as though you were logged in as Emily, not as the user that you're explicitly defined as. Let me show you. If I go into File Connections, yeah, look at this. I am explicitly defining that the default username for this connection is PyAdmin. But look who I'm logged in as. How did that happen? Well, it happened because the very first thing this connecting client does is it checks to see if there's a trust. If there is a trust, it will use the trust and it won't go any further. Now, you can demonstrate that the explicit login supersedes the trusts, but only by doing it manually. See, if I were to choose connect as from here, that is an explicit login. So I'll connect as the user PyAdmin, and now if I refresh this, you'll notice I am logged in as PyAdmin. So that's why sometimes you'll see that it really doesn't pay if you've got some of these, you know, these explicit trusts or these trusts set up in which you accidentally kind of get reduced down to a less powerful user, less privileged user, because you're matching a trust. So that's something to watch out for. It doesn't happen often, but occasionally that annoys our system managers. Now, to verify that an SDK-based client is connecting the way you expected it to, here's a procedure. You'll see it at the bottom of the lecture notes here. First of all, make sure that the PI user, or identify which user is going to be the default user when you try to connect. So I would do that by going into the connection dialog box, and I would look at how, for this particular server, what the default user is. Now verify, once you've done that, verify that that user requires a password. Now in this case, PyAdmin is the user. He doesn't require a password. I'm going to go ahead and change that. That's, by the way, that's a bad situation anyway. PyAdmin should always require a password. So I've gone ahead and verified that this requires a password. Let me see if that, if I've had privilege to make that change. There we go. Changed password. That's because I was currently logged in as PI user. And now, at this point, go ahead and start a client like Processbook and see how you log in. Actually, what I'm going to do is just exit out of this and start it up again. I'd rather do this. It's a little quicker than starting up Processbook. And it uses the same SDK-based connection. So now, start this up, and then try something that requires getting access to the data. So, for example, current values. I'm going to look at the current values of the tag sinusoid. So we'll do a tag search for sinusoid. We find lots of tags, so I'll go ahead and choose this one. And interestingly enough, I do have values. I've gotten values, and I wasn't prompted for a user and password prompt. So at this point, what we should do is take a look in the message log and see what the message log reported about this. So if I go into the message logs, and we should see the connection information. Yeah, here we go. Right here at 852, it says trust. Two liberal trust, that's the one I created, okay, is granted to that particular connection. And in fact, I was connected using, or I was given the privileges as the user Emily. So that's kind of surprising. Well, it's not surprising. As I said, we check to see if the trust exists first. So if that's not how you intended this to work, then either create a trust that is going to have a higher priority or higher score, or just eliminate this trust that's causing the problem for you. So for example, if I go in here and get rid of this trust, I will be able to explicitly use the login instead of the trust. Actually, I don't think I'm going to be able to do this because I'm currently logged in as Emily. Yeah, see, I don't think I'm going to be able to delete this trust. Yeah, here's our old friend, -10401. No write access. That's because I'm currently logged in as Emily because of that trust. So let me connect as PyAdmin, whose password is now set. And now that I'm logged in as PyAdmin, I'll go ahead and delete this trust. So the big finish is, once I've deleted it, there we go, we've deleted the trust. Now let's do that same thing. Let's exit. Let's come back in just as though we were coming into Processbook or some other client. And let's do something that requires connectivity. We'll go into data. We'll look at current values. And we should be at this point, since that, yeah, there we go, since that trust is no longer there, then the second procedure kicks in for these clients. Now, since they can't connect using a trust, they're going to connect using the explicit login. So I'll go ahead and type in my password for PyAdmin, and the big finish to this is now I should be able to see, and I am specifically logging in as PyAdmin. Yeah, so there's my current value, and if we look at connections, we are explicitly logged in as the PyAdmin user. So that's a test you can do just to verify that your users are getting the connections that you had intended for them, and not accidentally being shuttled off to a different user privileges based on an erroneous trust. Now, here's a couple of tips on troubleshooting an SDK-based client, and the SDK-based clients would be things like Processbook and data length and newer versions. So if you have an API-based client that can connect, like an interface or the older versions of Process Book, use pydiag-host. Okay? It's normally located in the py/admin directory. However, on a machine that's also running the Py server, you'll find that that directory doesn't exist. You actually launch that from the Py admin directory. Yeah, that's kind of an exception to the rule. You would typically not find a user who's running Process Book, Data Link, etc. on a Py server. But again, this computer I'm using here for testing purposes, it actually does not. It has a Py server on it, so in fact that utility is going to be under py/adm, not pypc. That's something that's very rarely going to affect, I think, most customers. But here's the utility, pydiag-host, great little utility that returns for us everything we ever needed to know about that connecting client. Its domain, its machine name, the current Windows user that's logged in, its IP address, etc. So compare those connection credentials against what you've configured in the trust table. Now, a second thing to look at is if you do have a trust defined that maps all Windows users to the corresponding Py users, just make sure that those Py users actually exist. That's a fairly common mistake. People don't know that those do have to match one for one. And then finally, if you do have multiple network interface cards that on a computer, and you are using a trust that's based on IP address to connect to the server, again, use pydiag-host. That's going to report to you what the connection or what the actual IP address is that we're going to be passing to the server. So pydiag-host, the IP address you see there is in fact the IP address that a PC with multiple network interface cards is going to be passing to the server.